Alrighty.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hello.
Hello, hello. Can you guys hear me on this? At the back, can you hear me on this? Let me see if I can plug this.
Can you still hear me at the back?
Awesome.
All right. Hi, everybody. My name's Nathan. I'm a third year at Eastern Health this year. I just finished rotating with the stroke team at Box Hill Hospital, which is interesting, except all the patients are the same. So in that sense, it's not. I'm going to be doing cardiology for you guys today. There is a lot of content to go through. I understand you guys had a year one physiology revision lecture, which didn't go over cardiophys. So I've tried to pack it all into one. We'll see how we go for timing. If you guys are flagging, we can break it up and do it another time, and I'll just send you guys all my material or have a second part to the lecture some other time. So we'll see how we go. So I'm doing embryology very, very, very quickly, anatomy, physiology, and a bit of path with questions throughout. Other things that you guys will or have got will be clin skills, so I'll try not to delve too much in that. Pharm and ECG. Did you guys have an ECG tutorial by Josh Monister? Okay. All right. If you ever meet Josh Monister again, to give you one. Excellent. All right. Let's start with embryology. Disclaimer, you will have one question maybe on embryology, so I'm going to fly through this. I will, however, give you the resources you need to learn it if you want to delve into it in more detail. These are excellent, excellent. This is a really, really fantastic website. This is a really good video which shows you kind of general concepts. But I'll touch quickly on the formation of the S-shaped heart, the development of AV valves and the different septa, the different primordial embryonic structures, fetal circulation and congenital anomalies. So, let's start. This is your final heart. It takes about 7 weeks for your heart to develop. And the process involves the joining of two primordial tubes together, the formation of different septa within these two tubes to create four chambers, the twisting of these tubes together to create your aorta and pulmonary trunk, as well as your valves. So this is more detail than you probably need. I've underlined the important things. So starting in the third week of fetal life, you have cardiogenic kind of cells that become your heart, move through what's called the primitive streak, and this is in your trilaminar disc, and they form the cardiac crest. Basically, you have two endocardial tubes that form on either side of the fetus, coming and meeting together in the midline, and this forms the first aortic arch. Within the third week and fourth week, you get rough borders of heart appearing and the layers of the heart forming from a jelly-like substance which is secreted from the myocardium, as well as the primary heart tube suspended in the place where the heart will develop by a mesocardium. In the fourth week, this is when you have partitioning between the atria and the ventricles start to form and the heart becoming S-shaped. That's a really important time period. The fourth week is when the heart becomes S-shaped. And I'll show you some images in a second. You'll get a better idea of what I'm talking about. In the fifth and sixth week is where you get really good differentiation between the heart chambers. You have endocardial cushions, which are pouches that form from the mesocardium, the endocardial walls as well. And they form the interatrial septa, interventricular septa, and the atrioventricular valve and septae. That's in the fifth and sixth week. In the seventh week, your ventricles divide, and your pulmonary artery and trunk communicate with their respective chambers. So, as I said, two tubes, essentially, which form in the midline, twisting into this S shape here. You've got the 23 and 24 days here. And then this is your final product. The endocardial cushions, might have a better image here, are these kind of invaginations of tissue which will form your, here, fused endocardial cushions, which will form your septa between each of your different chambers in the heart. quickly. This is a better image. I'm going to talk about the primary septum, septum primum, secundum, as well as the foramen ovale and the foramen secundum. So the septum primum is a structure that descends from the roof of what becomes the atria, and it descends, but not all the way, and it leaves a hole. That hole, as we know it, is the foramen primum. You can see it here. It's a descension here with a hole leaving the foramen primum. The septum undergoes partial apoptosis, leaving a second hole called the foramen secundum. They're both from the septum primum. The septum secundum is another wall that grows next to it, and it will form the boundaries of what will become the foramen ovale, which will exist up until its closure at birth, where it will form the fossa ovalis. The ventricles similarly have an interventricular septum that grows towards endocardial cushions, which will again form the valves. And then we have our two outflow tracts, which aren't very well visualized here. Our two outflow tracts will be here and here. We'll have the pulmonary trunk and the aorta. They are initially one outflow tract, and then they septate and they twist around each other to form two separate structures, the aorta and the pulmonary trunk here. This is a lot of detail. I wouldn't bother going into it too much, but for closure of your minds, here is all the detail you'll need and probably more. There are three shunts in fetal life, within the fetus before it's born, because their circulation is different to ours. They don't need circulation through their lungs and through their liver, and they also need external circulation. So the first shunt is the foramen ovale, which is a shunt between the right atrium and left atrium that allows the blood to bypass the pulmonary circulation and go straight into the left heart and out through the systemic circulation. When you breathe, as soon as you're born, the pressure within the pulmonary circulation increases, snapping closed this little valve here, and that becomes the fossa ovalis. The ductus venosus is here. It is a shunt that allows blood from the mother to bypass the hepatic circulation, because it's not necessary, and go straight into the IVC and then the cardiac circulation. The blood is filtered by the mother's liver, not by fetuses. Lastly is the ductus arteriosus. Basically allows any blood that doesn't pass through the foramen ovale and does enter the pulmonary trunk to not go through the pulmonary circulation and to enter the aorta and come back. It's kind of a safety mechanism to ensure that, again, no blood enters the pulmonary circulation. When that closes, it becomes the ligamentum arteriosum. The ductum venosum, when it closes, becomes the ligamentum venosum. Excuse me. This is the order of blood flow from placenta back to placenta, and I'll leave it there for you to look at. Quickly, congenital defects. The heart is a complicated structure embryologically, and it's prone to a lot of defects, particularly in things like Down syndrome, Marfan syndrome, Turner syndrome, a number of Ehlers-Danlos connective tissue diseases, things like that. Quickly, transposition is when the pulmonary artery and the aorta are in the wrong positions. They attach to the wrong ventricles. You can have abnormal septum secundum that allows mixing of blood abnormally. Premature closure of the foramen ovale means that in utero circulation doesn't actually make it into the systemic circulation from the heart, and babies usually die because of this, because they don't have proper circulation. The flip of that is a patent foramen ovale, which is when it doesn't close properly. Usually asymptomatic in life, particularly common in Down syndrome, but if they do get symptomatic, you kind of get a cyanotic picture because your blood isn't being properly oxygenated. There are more there. Teratology of Fallot are four particular anomalies that occur together. Bicuspid aortic valve will come up later when we talk about valvular disease. Essentially, the aortic valve has three leaflets or cuffs on it. This is when it has two. It's the most common congenital heart defect. Question. Choose the correct answer or answers. Apoptosis of the septum primum forms the foramen primum. A patent ductus venosum after birth allows deoxygenated blood to the left heart. The ductus arteriosus ensures no deoxygenated blood enters the left heart, and the endocardial cushions fuse to form the AV valves. Talk to the person next to you. Give you 15 seconds. All right, so the endocardial cushions fuse to form the atrioventricular valve. They also fuse to form the interatrial septa. You can go back to this image and have a learn of the different shunts there, but I'll leave that for another time. That was embryology. That was too long in embryology. You'll probably get one question or zero. Anatomy. I'm going to go over general anatomy, borders of the heart, the pericardium, the pericardial sinus, vasculature of the heart, heart walls and valves, and touch on some histology. The actual innervation of the heart we'll touch on in physiology. So, the heart, a double self-adjusting suction and pressure pump, the parts of which work in unison to propel blood to all parts of the body. It's from Kumar and Clark, I think, was a nice little description. The right heart receives deoxygenated blood from the SVC and the IVC, is pumped out through the pulmonary trunk and pulmonary arteries to the pulmonary circulation, where it is oxygenated, received back into the left heart via the pulmonary veins, left atrium, left ventricle, and pumped out into the systemic circulation. So, borders of the heart. The apex of the heart is formed mostly from the left ventricle. It's inferolaterally, it's the point of the heart, if you imagine it as a pyramid. The base, imagining as a pyramid, is actually the posterior surface of the heart, and is formed in the left atrium and a bit of the right atrium. Anteriorly is made mostly up of the right ventricle. Inferiorly, or the diaphragmatic surface, is mainly the left ventricle, because of the orientation of the heart, a bit of the right ventricle. And it's adherent to the central tendon of the diaphragm, so that when you breathe, your heart actually moves up and down. The right pulmonary surface is the right atrium, and the left pulmonary surface is, again, the left ventricle, and it forms that cardiac impression in the lung so that the heart sits nicely in that space there. This is important for things like trauma. If someone gets stabbed, you know which portion of the heart is likely to be injured. The heart is enclosed by the pericardium, which, as you remember, is that double-layered membrane that has a serous fluid in the middle of it and allows for the expansion of the heart in a setting that has very minimal friction. It has the fibrous and serous layers. The fibrous layer is on the outside, fused to the surrounding structures. And important anatomically is that the phrenic nerve runs between this fibrous outer layer and the mediastinal pleura on either side of the heart. The serous pericardium is the internal layer, and it has two layers, the parietal outside and the visceral, the one that's adherent to the actual heart layer. And in the middle is the pericardial cavity, which has a thin film of fluid, which allows for movement. It usually has about 15 to 20 mils of that serous fluid in there. The sinuses are two spaces enclosed within the pericardium. You have to cut into the pericardium to access them. The transverse pericardial sinus is what's pictured here. It's a complete sinus in that you can put your finger completely through it and allows clamping of some of the great vessels during cardiac procedures. The oblique pericardial sinus is on the posterior surface of the heart between the four pulmonary veins, and it doesn't really have a clinical significance apart from being a landmark during imaging. This is the vasculature of the heart. The coronary arteries are the arteries that supply the walls of the heart, the outer layers particularly, and they branch off the base of the aorta through the aortic ostia, the one ostium, two ostia. There's left and right main. This is the right coronary artery. 60% of the time, the right coronary artery will have a sinoatrial nodal branch, which supplies the sinoatrial node. Obviously, very important in regulating your heart rate, which we'll come to later. Both the left and right coronary arteries have a marginal artery, which usually run in the atrioventricular septum. Then most of the time, the right coronary artery will feed into the posterior interventricular artery, which is this one here on the back of the heart, and whichever coronary artery actually leads to the posterior interventricular artery is termed the dominant side of the heart. So in this case, the heart would be right dominant, as it usually is in two-thirds of the time. Finally, the right coronary artery typically feeds the AV node as well. Left coronary artery, up here, it's the left main, splits off into the left circumflex and the left anterior descending, which is, that terminology is kind of coming out of use now and moving into the anterior interventricular artery, which is a particularly important artery because it's termed the widowmaker artery. It's an artery that's really commonly affected in heart attacks, and because it supplies a really large portion of the left ventricle, which is the main outflow of the heart, when you have a heart attack here, you usually die, and hence it makes widows. So this is the LAD. Another branch, this is D1, the first diagonal artery here. And 33% of the time, it supplies the posterior interventricular. Talking about dominance there. So that's the left and right coronary arteries. This is dominance. The heart is also drains. The major vein of the heart is called the coronary sinus. It is a sinus, meaning it's a point of fusion of different vessels. We have the great, the middle, and the small cardiac vein, which each drain into them. And they supply different areas of the heart. Respectively, also not all the blood of the heart is drained into these vessels. Within the kind of endocardium and myocardium of the heart, there are very small, called smallest cardiac veins, and they drain the heart walls directly back into the heart, usually around the left atrium. So some of the blood gets drained externally, some just essentially goes straight back into the heart wall without any other circulation necessary. This is an acronym to remember which arteries run with which vessels. GAMSR, so the great cardiac vein, goes with your anterior interventricular artery, middle with the posterior, and small with the right marginal artery. Lymphatic drainage of the heart is not very important. It rarely gets infections. If it does get infections, we rarely do anything about them, which involves the lymph nodes. They're very hard to biopsy, and heart cancer is incredibly, incredibly rare. But the heart itself drains into the subepicardial lymphatic plexus, so within the layers of the heart wall, subepicardial, which usually drain up into the inferior tracheobronchial lymph nodes, which sit underneath the carina, and then drain and join the rest of your lymphatic flow in the thoracic duct here. Not very clinically important. The heart walls, three layers. First is the endocardium, the inner layer. It lines every surface of the heart as well as lining every single valve. The myocardium is the thickest and most important, probably, layer of the heart. It contains the muscles of the heart. And it's shaped, we'll show you a bit later, it's shaped in kind of a double helix so that when it contracts almost as if you're wringing out a towel to kind of have an optimal squeezing effect. And then the epicardium, which forms part of the visceral or the internal layer of the pericardium. These muscle fibers are anchored to a fibrous skeleton, which serves the points of attachment so that they can contract properly. This fibrous skeleton also forms the basis of all the valves in the heart. structural support, as well as forming insulation between the different areas of the heart so that your electrical energy doesn't pass straight between the atria and the ventricles without going through a specific pathway, which we'll talk about in a second. Heart valves split up into atrioventricular, separating the atria and the ventricles, and the semilunar because of their shape. So the first valve of the heart is the tricuspid valve. Remember, tri before you buy. Tricuspid valve is first, separating the right atrium and right ventricle. It's three cusped. The other atrioventricular valve is the mitral or bicuspid. It's two cusped, bicuspid. Then the semilunar valves are your valves that are at the outflows of each ventricle, the aortic and the pulmonary. Both are tricuspid. Each of them, the valves are held down by chordae tendinae, which are fibrous strands which ensure the structure of them, and papillary muscles. The papillary muscles contract and make sure that valves don't prolapse out into other ventricles when there's force being exerted on the valves. This is a nice little GIF I found. shows when this ventricle is contracting, for example, that this, the tricuspid valve, is closing. And similarly on either side, this is pulmonary and aortic is back through here, which you can't quite see. Cool. histology. So this is a blood vessel. There are three layers of each blood vessel, the innermost of which is the tunica intima. It's endothelial, it's squamous cells, and it usually has a supporting basement membrane and is fairly elastic as well. The tunica media, as with most things, the middle layer is the muscular layer. It has smooth muscle, concentric bands around the vessel, and its contraction is regulated by autonomic nervous system as well as local kind of endothelial factors, which we'll talk about in a second. And the outside is the tunica adventitia, which is collagenous and provides structural support. And in the larger vessels like the aorta, the IVC, SVC, the vasa vasora, which are a small network of vessels, run over the tunica adventitia and supply the outer layers of the vessels, because those vessels are so thick that the diffusion from the inside of the vessel is enough to get to the outer layers. This is a quick overview of the different sizes of different vessels in the body and the difference in their structure. For example, arterioles are just endothelium and smooth muscle surrounding them and don't have that same tunica externa that others do, or the adventitia, if you call it. Some more detail on that. Your large elastic arteries are your aorta and your subclavian and other tributaries. They, during systole, blood is pumped into these large arteries and they're quite elastic, so they distend and they act as a partial reservoir during systole. So that during diastole, when there's no more pressure exerted on them, those walls will collapse inwards and further push out blood to the rest of your body, so that blood in your body moves continuously through tissue and not in bursts as the heart pushes. These are exposed to the highest pressure, obviously, as they're the closest to the heart. And then as you go through the muscular medium-sized arteries, you have less and less pressure. Then to your arterioles, where you have the largest fall in pressure across them. And then finally, your capillaries, where there's the lowest pressure, the slowest movement of blood in tissue to ensure that there's proper diffusion of nutrients into tissue and waste products back out of tissue. Notably, the capillaries are surrounded by pericytes, which are just contractile cells, which can help regulate the flow of blood into different tissues. Arterioles, as you can see, have the greatest drop in pressure. And then pressure slowly builds up in the pulmonary vasculature as well. Capillaries are of three different types. There are continuous, which have an endothelial lining which is uninterrupted, continuous. held together by tight junctions, which only allow small molecules to move between them. These happen in tissues where you don't want a lot of movement between blood and tissue, like in the blood-brain barrier. Middle ones are fenestrated. They are in tissues which you want more exchange of fluid, like in the gut, where you want to absorb lots of fluids. So they're fenestrated, which means they have little windows all throughout the endothelium, but not in the basement membrane. And then there are sinusoid capillaries, which have gaps in the basement membrane as well as in the endothelium and allow movement of large structures such as red blood cells. And this happens in places where you want that movement of cells between spaces in the body, like in the bone marrow and lymph. So, question. A penetrating injury in the left anterior chest wall is most likely to injure what? So remember back to the borders of the heart, that the right ventricle, because of the orientation of the heart, makes up most of the anterior surface of the heart. The transverse pericardial sinus is what? The transverse sinus can be entered to clamp the pulmonary trunk here and aorta as well. All the other descriptions are of the cul-de-sac, and this one is just incorrect. The IVC can't be clamped from either sinus. Which vessels open up into the right atrium? So the coronary sinus, which is the largest vein, opens into the right atrium, which is where all the rest of your deoxygenated blood goes to. And the smallest cardiac veins are those ones which exist within the heart wall and drain directly into the atrium without going externally to the heart. Which vessel lies in the anterior atrioventricular groove? So it's not the anterior interventricular. The anterior interventricular runs in the interventricular groove. This is atrioventricular. The right coronary artery runs in the anterior atrioventricular groove, which is also called the right atrioventricular groove. The fibrous skeleton of the heart does what? Multiple answers. The last three. So it ensures that your electrical energy moves in only the specific pathways you want it to, which we'll talk about later. The myocardia all attached to this fibrous skeleton because, as you know, all muscles need an anchoring point in either end so they can contract and move, and they provide structural support for the valves. Choose the correct statement about valves. So, the answer is the mitral valve. Mitral or bicuspid valve is bicuspid, therefore it's an AV valve on the left side of the heart. The aortic valve is tricuspid and semilunar. Pulmonary valve, tricuspid again, semilunar. The tricuspid valve is obviously tricuspid and it's an AV valve. AV valves close during ventricular systole so that the blood goes out through the semilunar valves, not back into atria if the AV valves are open. The vasa vasorum are what? So, the answer is A. They are nerves, they're not nerves, sorry. They are veins and arteries that lie on the tunica adventitia, the externalmost layer, and they supply the outer layers only of vessels, not all of them, and there are no nerves within them. The largest drop in pressure in the circulatory system occurs across what? Yell it out. Someone mumbled it. Arterioles, good. That's phys. That's anatomy. This is phys. So that was a very quick fly through anatomy. Are there any questions? So it may not necessarily be clinical. You may get a picture, a dissection of vessels, of heart, of valves, of anything, of the inside of the heart opened up and looking at the internal structures, and they'll say, what is that? Clinical things will relate to particular diseases, like which valves are most affected in this particular disease, or this valve, when stenosed or in regurgitating, will result in a murmur at this particular time, or things like trauma. You know, someone gets stabbed in the chest, where they're most likely to go, things like that. So, unfortunately, you just have to know it all, because they can give you either. Phys. So, there's a lot of cardiophys. This is what I'm going to go over. Let's do it. The cardiovascular system serves to ensure that tissues function, and this means it gives them all that they need to function and removes the products of their metabolism. It also thermoregulates and plays a role in immune functioning. Blood flows starting in the heart, the right atrium to right ventricle, through the pulmonary system and then into the left heart. Goes out through the aorta and arteries, smaller and smaller and smaller, arterioles, capillaries, and then returns in the venules, the larger veins, the larger superior and inferior vena cavae, and then back into the heart. The microcirculation, which are these three smallest ones, are the sites where the blood flows the slowest, under the lowest pressure, and the site where that exchange of substances occurs. So, to understand this, we need to understand flow. Flow is essentially how much fluid moves over a certain specific period of time. And in this circumstance, flow is essentially equal to pressure. So if someone has high blood pressure, their flow is going to be faster in that particular area. This is true if the flow is laminar, which is your normal silent flow. If someone has turbulent flow, you can have high flow, but because the blood is moving in a disorganized fashion, the pressure may be low because it's not organized. And this is loud, it's abnormal, it's associated with diseases like atherosclerosis and stenosis, valvular disease. and any state in which the body has to work harder to get its cardiac output, so anemia, hypothyroidism, pregnancy, for example. These can all give you murmurs in your heart, which aren't associated with valvular disease. They're associated with increased flow. Formulas to know about flow. So flow is a change in pressure over a resistance and can be calculated across an organ. So if you look at the arterial pressure going into the kidney versus the venous pressure coming out of the kidney, that'll give you your change in pressure across the kidney. And because resistance is important to flow, this is an important equation to memorize, where the resistance in a vessel is proportional to, first of all, the viscosity of the blood, which is calculated using your hematocrit, how dense essentially the blood is and how well it flows, the length of the vessel that the blood is flowing through, which doesn't really change, and the resistance in the vessel. This is altered in states of disease, like atherosclerosis, or when the smooth muscle surrounding arteries contracts. And this smooth muscle contraction is what mostly changes resistance in blood vessels. Cardiac output is how much blood your heart is pumping out, and so it is how many times per minute your heart pumps times by how much blood your heart pumps per stroke, heart rate times stroke volume. The mean average arterial pressure is equal to the cardiac output, so how much blood is being pumped out, times by the resistance against which the cardiac output has to flow. It can also be approximated by calculating 2/3 of diastolic pressure and 1/3 of systolic pressure. And this is because your heart is in systole 1/3 of the time and in diastole 2/3 of the time. They can ask you to calculate things based on these equations, so worth knowing. The ejection fraction is essentially how much blood you eject out of the total blood that you can eject. So it's the stroke volume, how much you pump out, over the end diastolic volume, which is how much volume there is in the ventricle at the end of diastole, at the end of the filling of the heart. And in chronic heart disease, your ejection fraction goes down and down and down and is used as a marker of pathological progression. The preload is essentially the same as the end diastolic volume, except it's a pressure. It's the stretching of the ventricle during diastole. And we'll talk about the Frank-Starling mechanism in a second. That's where that comes into play. The afterload is the opposite. It's the peripheral pressure against which the cardiac output pumps. So if you have high peripheral pressure, like an atherosclerosis or peripheral vascular disease, your heart has to pump harder to get the blood out, and that can give you something like hypertension. On the other side is venous return. Your veins are highly distensible and they act as a volume reservoir for your blood. They hold up to 60% of your blood's, your body's blood. What drives the return in blood is the difference between the peripheral pressure and the pressure inside the right atrium, which is kind of given the zero term. Because blood flows, as we said before, from a high pressure to a low pressure, those changes make your venous blood come back to your right heart. This pressure is determined by how much blood there is in the veins, how compliant the vein walls are, and around them, how much the smooth muscle is contracting around veins, and that contracts when you have sympathetic input there. When you have increased venous pressure, they will respond like the heart by giving increased venous return in a functional venous state. Other things that aid in venous return are the skeletal pumps. Because your veins have valves in them, when your muscles contract around them, they squash them and blood will go up and down the vein, but it can't go down very far because there are valves along the way. So most of it will come up, it'll pass by a valve, and then when the muscle relaxes, it can only come back down to that valve that's already passed. And so it aids in the ascension of the venous blood back up. respiratory pump, basically any changes in intrathoracic pressure. So you, when you breathe in, you're increasing the volume inside your thorax, and that acts as a, it kind of induces a negative pressure in the circulation and pulls up the blood. And cardiac suction is also something I like to talk about, which is basically when the atria expands during diastole and the AV valve kind of plops downwards towards the ventricle, it creates another little negative pressure and sucks it back in. Similar mechanism to how the respiratory pump works. So that's a bit of cardiac output, preload and afterloads. Now the following three things have major effects on how the heart pumps. The first is the intrinsic cardiac regulation in response to changes in volume, which is also known as the Frank-Starling mechanism, which essentially means in a functional heart, the amount of volume of blood that enters the ventricle will be pumped out. When more blood enters the ventricle stretches more, the filaments of the myocardium align more properly so that they can contract more strongly, and all the rest of that blood will be pumped out, essentially. You're increasing your stroke volume when the amount of blood in your ventricles increase, and therefore, in response, your cardiac output will go up because of this equation here. When you can't meet the needs of your heart, and your heart can't pump out enough blood to meet the needs of your body, this is called heart failure, which we'll talk about in a second. So that's an intrinsic mechanism of regulation of cardiac output based on volume. The second is the autonomic nervous system. There's sympathetic and parasympathetic, which is the vagus nerves, essentially. Talking about the vagus nerves first, they regulate heart rate more than heart contraction or strength. And because of that, they go mostly to the nodes, AV and SA nodes. The heart is under a constant vagal tone. We're constantly having vagal tone exerted upon us, and it can decrease and increase based on what we're doing. But its resting state is vagal, essentially. The sympathetics, coming from your sympathetic trunk here, your ganglia, are distributed across the heart with a particular emphasis on the ventricles, and so they will increase the heart rate as well as the strength of contraction of the heart. And this happens in your fight or flight. Quickly on that note, your circulating hormones, your catecholamines, will also increase your sympathetic drive to the heart, resulting in the same outcome. So the second is autonomics. Third, quickly, is extracellular ions. If there is a patient in hospital who is on dialysis and isn't clearing their ions properly, and they have a potassium of 7 millimoles per liter, they will get straight onto dialysis right away because there is a chance that in less than an hour they're going to have a fatal arrhythmia. Extracellular potassium is the most dangerous ion. It's associated with fatal arrhythmias, as I said. It gives a dilated, flaccid, bradycardic heart. And basically, because of its interactions with cell membranes, it lowers membrane resting potential, meaning that it's much harder to excite ions, to excite cells, rather, and it blocks conduction all through the heart. On the flip side, high extracellular calcium is needed for the contraction of the heart. It gives a spastic contraction of the heart, again, impeding upon cardiac output and can also result in an arrhythmia. Luckily, both of these ion levels are really well regulated in the heart, but this is what they do if they get out of whack. Mean arterial pressure is regulated by two important reflexes, the baroreceptor reflex and the chemoreceptor reflex. These two reflexes communicate with the medulla in the cardiovascular center of the medulla, which is divided up into an accelerator and an inhibitor section. Accelerator essentially is your sympathetic activation center, and your inhibitor is your parasympathetics. And these integrate signals from these two reflexes and then send out signals to your heart and the vasculature around it to mediate blood pressure and mean arterial pressure. So when you have your sympathetics activated, your arterioles and your veins constrict, increasing total peripheral resistance and shunting blood back into your heart, because if your veins are constricted, they're not going to hold as much blood, so the blood is going to travel more easily back to the right heart, increasing end diastolic volume. And the heart itself will have direct sympathetic activation to beat faster and stronger. So you'll have Frank Starling initiation of increased cardiac output, as well as direct sympathetic activation. And the exact opposite occurs in parasympathetic activation. So the first reflex is the baroreceptor reflex. Baro means temperature. It's initiated by stretch receptors in the carotid sinuses of the external carotid artery and in the aortic arch. Internal carotid artery, my apologies, and aortic arch. When there is more pressure inside these structures, the walls stretch and distend, and that is what these receptors sense. So they fire when they are stretched. When they are not being stretched, they don't fire. This is the more sensitive of these two reflexes, so it'll fire first if there's high blood pressure, for example. They send signals to that center we talked about via the nucleus tractus solitarius. It's via the hypoglossal and vagus nerves as well, and or either inhibits or excite those different centers. The baroreceptor reflex is activated when there's high blood pressure, so it will inhibit vasoconstriction and excite the parasympathetic so that your vessels will relax and you'll have less pressure in those areas. It also acts on your catecholamines from your adrenal medulla to, again, give a sympathetic or lack thereof response. And this is a particularly important reflex when you go from lying to standing because you have really big pressure changes within your circulation. And if it wasn't for these, every time you went from lying to stand up, you just faint because you'd get no blood flow to your head because you have no adaption mechanism. The second reflex is the chemoreceptor reflex. It senses chemicals, not pressure. It senses hydrogen ions, carbon dioxide ions, and oxygen deficits. Hydrogen ions and carbon dioxide ions are kind of the same thing because carbon dioxide becomes an acid, carbonic acid, but essentially it senses high carbon dioxide or low oxygen, which occurs in decreased blood flow states because you have buildup of your metabolites, which are typically hydrogen positives. Again, located in the carotid bodies and in the aortic arch, they have a vessel that runs through them so that they're closely in touch with the circulation and can quickly monitor that. However, they're less sensitive than the baroreceptor reflex. So the baroreceptor reflex will be initiated first before the chemoreceptors are. So the chemoreceptor and the baroreceptor reflex are responsible for your really short-term modulation of mean arterial pressure, like within 15 seconds. Long-term control of blood pressure is done by your kidneys, which I'm not going to cover. Another thing that regulates blood pressure at a very local area is the endothelium, which is responsible for the synthesis and secretion of lots of different factors. Your vasodilators are here. Most notably is your nitric oxide, and your vasoconstrictors, most noticeably your endothelin, which is your strongest one. Endothelium has a number of other functions, which I won't touch on. So your endothelium begins to lose its function with everyone, with age. It's also associated with atherosclerosis and other vascular and cardiovascular diseases or pathological states, as listed there. Also, early in life, if you have undernutrition as a baby, you aren't feeding well, and you're exposed to hypoxia as a fetus or as a child, a baby, that can affect how your endothelium functions in life. So nitric oxide is probably the most important endothelial factor. It's one of the endothelial relaxing factors. It's lipid soluble, it's gas, it's got a very short half-life, and it works very fast. With all endothelial factors. What triggers their release is a shearing force. A shearing force is a force which is the opposite to the normal force. It's not perpendicular to the plane, it's parallel, so it's a force running with the direction of the vessel, and it's increased in increased blood flow, and therefore you'd want your vasodilators in that state. As we mentioned before, capillaries and small vessels are surrounded by smooth muscle. Nitrous oxide diffuses through vessels into smooth muscle cells and facilitates the relaxation of those smooth muscles, resulting in vasodilation. It has lots of other functions as well, but notably it's a vasodilator, particularly in the larger conduit arteries. A quick note on how it's synthesized and then a disease state of that synthesis. Endothelial nitric oxide synthase is the enzyme responsible for the production of nitrous oxides. It is synthesized from this amino acid, L-arginine, and requires this cofactor, BH4. Essentially, if you block this functioning, you should have a direct response and a decreased nitrous oxide production, and that's called a coupled response. In conditions such as diabetes, you have increased production of reactive oxygen species, and you have you get a deficit of this cofactor B4, meaning that your nitric oxide synthase can't work. It doesn't have that necessary cofactor. And you get the formation of these reactive oxygen species. And essentially, when you block the function of this enzyme, nitric oxide synthase, your resulting nitrous oxide production changes very little because they're out of whack with each other, and that's called uncoupled. That was just a note that someone harped on about in some lecture, and I thought we may as well include it. So that's short-term regulation of mean arterial pressure. Let's talk about the heart and contraction of the heart. The heart has three different types of muscle: ventricular, atrial, and specialized excitatory muscle. The atrial and ventricular muscle are similar to skeletal. They're contractile. The only notable difference is that the contraction in cardiac muscle lasts much longer than in skeletal muscle, ensuring that there's proper squeezing out of blood and outflow into the peripheries. And the excitatory fibers don't contract. That's not their purpose. Their purpose is to conduct electricity and to be autorhythmic, to generate their own rhythm. So cardiac muscle, like skeletal muscle, is striated, composed of actin and myosin. The difference is you have these intercalcated discs here, which are extensions of cell membrane into different areas within this syncytium, which is our kind of conglomerate of cardiac muscle fibers. Because of these discs, ions are move very quickly between the different strands and allows for all of this muscle to contract as one, which is important to ensure you have a good pumping action. The heart isn't made up of one syncytium, it's made up of two, atrial and ventricular, so that the atria pump just before the ventricles, so blood is pumped from atria into ventricles and outward. This is your ventricular action potential. The major difference between this and your normal skeletal muscle action potential is this plateau, as I said, allowing for proper pumping of the heart. And I'll go into that in a second. Like skeletal muscle, it has a normal resting membrane potential and needs external excitation in order to propagate an action potential. So, resting membrane potential is around, usually quoted as negative 90 millivolts and 96, whatever. Your sodium potassium pumps are active, keeping sodium outside the cell and potassium inside, and you also have sodium calcium pumps active there. This depolarization is triggered by voltage-gated sodium channels, which results in a very fast influx of sodium cells, sodium ions into the cell. This is not dissimilar from the skeletal muscle action potential. The difference is this plateau. What happens here is you have the slow or L-type voltage-gated calcium channels opening here. And so you have calcium coming in, you have potassium leaving, and they kind of act in balance with each other, resulting in this plateau, facilitating a sustained muscular contraction here. And then, like in the other action potentials, you have your potassium efflux and your rapid repolarization and return to baseline potential here with a refractory phase, as with all other cells, where the membrane comes back to its steady states and then can be ready to be excited again. So the important thing essentially in the ventricles is this channel here, your slow voltage-gated calcium channels, which gives you this plateau. Pacemaker cells. Pacemaker cells, as I'm sure you know, have a funny current, which is an ongoing influx of sodium, which means that the membrane potential is constantly rising. It doesn't require external excitation. It does it itself. It's a pacemaker cell. It creates the pace. No external stimulus required. So comes up to here. As with other action potentials, it reaches a threshold. And at this stage, your same channels, those L-type calcium channels, open and have your depolarization. And then your repolarization is by the same mechanisms. You have your calcium channels closing, potassium opening, same as before. So, a crucial part of muscle contraction is the excitation-contraction coupling, the mechanism by which action potentials result in contraction. We have our T-tubules, which are invaginations of the cellular membrane into the actual muscle fibers, so that the extracellular fluid actually exists within this space here. So two things happen. One is that an action potential moves through and down these T-tubules and activates release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum here, as I said here. Calcium is needed for the contraction process. This is not dissimilar to your skeletal muscle. The difference in cardiac muscle is that not only is calcium released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, but calcium is also enters the cell from the extracellular fluid. So there is calcium in this extracellular fluid, and it is an action potential facilitates the entry of calcium into the cells, so that there is a dual calcium entry into the intracellular cytoplasm or sarcoplasm. This calcium that enters the cell facilitates further calcium release from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and that's what your calcium-induced calcium release is. Calcium entering the cell this way activates the ryanodine receptor channels on the sarcoplasmic reticulum, causing that extra calcium influx. So the strength of contraction is essentially due to the length of the myocardial filaments and the concentration of extracellular calcium. If you take a heart out of someone's body and you bathe it in an extracellular fluid, and fluid that makes up the right levels of sodium and potassium, it'll beat by itself. But if you take out calcium, it won't. So where do these muscles get their electrical energy from? The electrical conduction system of the heart, which is important because it generates rhythm by itself and conducts it rapidly through the heart so that the heart contracts in time. Starting, as you know, I'm sure, at the SA nodes, traveling through internodal bundles and interatrial bundles to the AV nodes, then through the bundle of His, which has left and right branches, then through Purkinje fibers into the ventricles themselves. The SA node is your primary pacemaker. It generates its own beats at approximately 70 beats per minute. However, in the case that the SA node is dysfunctional after ischemia or sick sinus syndrome, the AV node can take over. It's not such a good pacemaker. It generates beats at about 50 beats per minute. So someone who has an AV node, which is their primary pacemaker, will be bradycardic always. Finally, if the AV node and the SA node is not working, as in an atrioventricular complete heart block, the Purkinje fibers will initiate a pacemaker electrical signal by themselves, but again, much slower again, usually 15 to 40 beats per minute, as in this situation here. You can have an ectopic pacemaker anywhere in the heart, in the atrial wall, in the ventricular wall, and this is an area of heart tissue which is dysfunctional and creates its own beats by itself, and that can result in something like rapid AF, where you have a heart beating at 300 to 400 beats per minute. This is an overview of that pathway, the conduction pathway. Bachmann's bundle is an important interatrial conduction pathway. So, sinoatrial node, the primary pacemaker of the cell. As you said, it has funny currents. It's found at the junction of the SVC and the top of the right atrium. It conducts very quickly at this stage in the heart. There is no need to delay any signals in the atria. In fact, you want them to get to both sides at the same time, so the atria conduct essentially at the same time. And there are three of these internodal pathways, the anterior, middle, and posterior, for interest. The AV node is different from the SA node because here we want to delay the conduction signal. As opposed to 0.03 seconds at the SA node, here it's more than a tenth of a second, which is quite a lot in terms of the heart's entire conduction system. This delay is facilitated by this fibrous resistant tissue at the AV node, which slows the conduction through the AV node and ensures that the atria have time to contract and push blood into the ventricles before the ventricles themselves contract and push all that blood out into the pulmonary and systemic circulation. The conduction signals leave the AV bundle, the AV node, excuse me, via the bundle of His, which has left and right branches and runs down through the interventricular septum. This is the bundle of His here, left and right branches. The left branch divides into anterior and posterior fascicles, each of which can be blocked, for example, and you can get different forms of left heart block depending on which fascicle is blocked. And then each of the left and right branches then transition into Purkinje fibers, which are very large, very thick fibers, which conduct speeds up to 5 meters per second, which is very fast. And this ensures that the ventricles, which are very large and are very thick, get electrically excited at the same time and produce contraction of ventricles at the same time. This is the timing of the entire process of electrical conduction, and you can see that the bundles of His start, they end at the apex of the ventricles. The Purkinjes start at the apex and make their way around to the tops of the ventricles each way. The entire process only takes 0.22 or 0.21 of a second, remembering that more than 0.1 of a second is actually spent at the AV node. So about half the time is spent going through the AV node in the entire conduction pathway. This electrical excitation results in the cardiac cycle, which has 4 or 5 stages. Some people split the first 2 stages up into 1A and 1B, but essentially the first stage is filling of the ventricles passively. The AV valves are open. There is no electrical activity here. The filling is just due to a pressure difference, so the ECG is silent. Following this is atrial contraction. atrial contraction is this part here, which interestingly is not part of systole, it's actually part of diastole. This ensures that blood is pumped into the ventricles before ventricles contract. This is the P wave on an ECG. Then, two sections of ventricular contraction. First is isovolumetric, iso meaning the same. So it is the time when the ventricles are contracting, but the volume in the ventricle isn't changing. So the AV valves are closed. They close at this point, and the semilunar valves are also closed. The blood isn't going anywhere. The pressure is just building up inside the ventricle until a point at which the ventricular pressure is greater than either the aortic or the pulmonary pressure, which opens these semilunar valves, the aortic and pulmonary valves, ejecting the blood from the ventricles. So isovolumetric contraction is here, which increases pressure in the ventricles but maintains the same ventricular volume, and then you have your ejection where the valves open and the volume is decreasing. Then your valves close, which is your second heart sound, and ventricles relax, decreasing the volume of the ventricles. As I said before, the heart wall is shaped like a double helix of sorts, or a single helix even. And when they ring, welcome back. When it contracts, it's like a tower ringing out, which is the most effective way of pumping out blood. So, that was a very quick, not so quick, I guess, overview of cardiophys. We went through flow and regulation of cardiac output and mean arterial pressure. We also talked about the conduction system, the different action potentials of the heart and cardiac cycle as well. So, some questions. If the radius of a vessel halves, what happens to the resistance? So remembering your equation, resistance is the most important factor, radius. Radius is the most important factor in resistance. It is to the fourth power, so if R becomes half, half to the 4 is 1/16, put the 16 on the top, 16 the amount of resistance. The mean arterial pressure is approximately what? Remember, the heart is in diastole 2/3 of the time and systole 1/3 of the time. So that's a fairly accurate approximation of the mean arterial pressure there. Activation of the cardioaccelerator center in the brain causes what? Remember, this is your sympathetic outflow center. So, these are the things that happen when the cardioaccelerator center is active. Your arterioles and your veins both constrict to shunt blood from the peripheries into the heart itself, and the heart is stimulated to beat stronger and faster. So it all is trying to increase your cardiac output. The chemoreceptor reflex. the chemoreceptor reflex increases when exposed to hydrogen ions, so that's the same as an acidic environment, and is less sensitive than the baroreceptor reflex. Nitric oxide is a what? Good D. It's a vasodilator. The correct things are BH4 is the cofactor, vasodilator, and C is released in response to increased pressure within capillaries, which isn't exactly right. It's shear force. The difference, as I said, is the direction of the force on the vessel wall. If you think about a balloon, blowing up a balloon, that's the same as putting pressure on the walls of a vessel, and the pressure is perpendicular to the walls and it pushes it outwards. This is shear, it's in the same direction. In a cardiomyocyte, the membrane potential increases when what? So this is not in a pacemaker, this is in a heart muscle cell. Sodium, it's always sodium. So your voltage-gated sodium channels open and you have a fast influx into the heart muscle fiber. The voltage-gated calcium channels are slow. They're slow to open, and so that happens later. And they're also slow to close, giving you your plateau. In a cardiomyocyte again, the membrane potential decreases rapidly when what happens? So the decline is always potassium, potassium diffusing out of the muscle cell, decreasing the intracellular positive charge and decreasing the resting membrane potential back down. The rapid increase in membrane potential in a cardiac pacemaker cell occurs when what happens? The rapid increase. So your funny channels are what open all the time, and that results in the slow increase. But when you reach that threshold voltage, your voltage-gated L-type slow calcium channels open, giving you that sharp rise. With the person next to you, name all these. All right. So Beckman's bundle is one of the names, interatrial pathways. And you have your nodes with their internodal paths. So that wasn't even labeled. Left and right bundles of your bundle of His, including this is the left posterior bundle, you had a 50% chance guessing, and Purkinje fibers. This one? This one. Happy to help. Also, when you guys were working this out, I just saw 100 people do this and then do this. It was really funny. Atrial systole occurs when what? So, atrial systole occurs during diastole, confusingly. It happens when ventricular volume is high. So, atrial systole occurs when ventricular volume is quite high. The ventricles are nearly primed, nearly full, ready to contract, and the atria contract just to get that last bit of blood out into them, and then the ventricles contract immediately afterwards because the ventricles have already passively filled with blood. Ventricular pressure is low because they're not contracting, and the semilunar valves are closed so that they go between the atria and the ventricles. PAF. So you guys are having clin skills lectures. And the focus of second year isn't massively on pathology. That you'll do that a lot more next year. So I've done a bit of an overview of some of the important things. I won't go into too much detail. If you have questions, stop me though. These are what I'll be going over. Atherosclerosis, coronary artery disease, and acute coronary syndromes, valvular disease, heart failure, problems with the aorta, endocarditis, and pericardial disease. So atherosclerosis is something that everyone will get in Western society. It is the buildup of fat and inflammatory cells and smooth muscle proliferation on the inside of vessel walls. Happens with age, more so if you're male and if you have a family history of atherosclerosis. Other things like dyslipidemia, hypertension, diabetes, smoking result in it, and there are other minor risk factors as well which haven't particularly been confirmed. Things like diet, interestingly, doesn't have a clear link to atherosclerosis. Basically, all of your cardiovascular risk factors are risk factors because they give you some sort of atherosclerosis, and this underpins a majority of cardiovascular diseases. In Western society, by the time you're 20, you probably already have fatty streaks in your veins and vessels, which is great, but we won't know about it for years. So, atherosclerosis is a progressive buildup of a number of factors on the inside of a vessel wall, starting with lipid accumulation and macrophage phagocytosis, giving you what's called foam cells because they look like foam histologically, apparently. This particularly happens at areas where there is disruption of flow, so things like the bifurcation of high pressure vessels, like in the carotids or the iliacs. There's accumulation of inflammatory cells, T lymphocytes particularly, in the subendothelium here. And essentially you get increased lipid accumulation here with a lipid core and then a fibrous cap on top, leading to progressive occlusion of a vessel. Thanks for coming. Which is okay. It's not great. But it's better than if your plaque ruptures. So when you have a stable plaque, you have stenosis and you have decreased blood flow through, and it gives you things like stable angina, which is where you get symptoms, which is predictable because you have a stable pathological state. If your plaque ruptures, the contents of this plaque are prothrombotic. So when it ruptures, all the surrounding blood wants to clot very quickly, and this is when you can get things like strokes. So it's progressive deposition of inflammatory cells, fats, smooth muscle proliferation, and kind of fibrous cap. silent for decades and then increasingly clinically obvious. So, this, as we know, decreases the radius of the vessel, which increases the resistance, which increases the mean arterial pressure, which increases your cardiac output, which gives you hypertension. It also gives you things like peripheral vascular disease or diseases in which your peripheries are not well perfused and can lead you to have things like ischemic limbs, venous or arterial ulcers peripherally, particularly in conjunction with things like diabetes. This narrowing is called stenosis and is what gives ischemic heart disease and can lead on to full-blown heart attacks. If it ruptures, you can get your thrombus formation going to wherever they flick off. Head gives you stroke, limbs, ischemic limbs. You can get ischemic mesentitis, mesenteric ischemia is what I'm looking for. Ischemic gut, which can give you a very fast, very painful, bloody diarrhea. And this abnormal growth on the wall can decrease the strength of the vessel wall, making you prone to aneurysm formation, typically triple A formation, which if it ruptures is very bad. So coronary artery disease is the most obvious complication of atherosclerosis and is in two main categories, stable angina, and then your acute coronary syndrome, which are these three main conditions, unstable angina, NSTEMI, and STEMI. Angina is a sensation related to myocardial ischemia. It's also a diagnosis in itself. You can say this patient has stable angina, but it is a description of a sensation, essentially. The pain is felt in the same area as you feel heart attacks. It's the same type of pain, so central crushing chest pain radiating typically to the shoulders, in the back, down the arm, up the neck, to the jaw, wherever you want. Women have a different pain pattern, so you can feel it in other places, like the right side or a more predominant pain in the back. And beware the diabetic who have silent heart attacks. I was on the cardio team in Box Hill about a month ago. We had a lady who came in with angina, did all the relevant investigations. She was fine. We're about to send her back home, did a final set of OBS on her, and she was tachycardic, about 105, not massive. So we were going to discharge her, but someone pushed to get an ECG done. She was having a massive anterior interventricular, complete 100% occlusion heart attack right there in the ward, and no one realized that she was completely fine, feeling great, excited to go home, and was having a massive heart attack because she was diabetic. So within 5 minutes, she was in the cath lab, having an angiogram, and having her LAD opened up, and because the nurse said we should do an ECG on this lady before she gets discharged, she's alive. So beware the diabetic. Was that point? The sensation of myocardial ischemia typically happens in coronary artery disease. It can also happen in states where your blood is not perfusing well enough into the tissue or there's a lack of. So things like arrhythmias, which has decreased cardiac output, or anemia in which blood and oxygen isn't carried as well. Stable angina is predictable. It happens after exercise and goes away very quickly, within 5 minutes or so, after you rest. It is a marker of decreased cardiovascular health, but is not a very serious state to be in. It's managed. You manage all your cardiovascular risk factors and monitor. Unstable angina, or crescendo, increasing angina, is part of your acute coronary syndromes. It's basically angina which is either happening, it's new onset angina, or it's happening more frequently or for a longer duration, or the pain is worse. So it's a marker of progression of the pathological state. So that's the first of the acute coronary syndromes. And then there are your NSTEMI and STEMI. These are your heart attacks where you have myocardial ischemia. In an NSTEMI, a non-ST elevated myocardial infarct or a non-ST elevated acute coronary syndrome, see it written as well, there is no ST elevation on ECG. It's diagnosed on the basis of your classic central crushing chest pain and cardiac biomarkers like troponins and CK. STEMI is transmural, so the entire thickness of the wall ischemia, and that gives you your ST elevation. An NSTEMI happens when you have critical stenosis of coronary arteries, so, you know, 70, 80, 90% stenosis, and your STEMI, your complete ischemia, happens when there's complete occlusion, like when a plaque ruptures and completely blocks off a coronary vessel, and that results in death of the entire thickness of the wall because there's a complete deficit. So, quickly, a bit of clinical stuff. Central crushing chest discomfort, sometimes not described as pain. It's the best description I heard is someone said, oh, there's, it feels like an elephant is stepping on my chest. There's a mic there. Stepping on my chest, and I just can't breathe. There's pressure on my chest. So when you're asking about it, don't necessarily say pain, say discomfort. Radiates to all sorts of places, and you get lots of constitutional symptoms. Feel sweaty, feel not quite right, lightheaded. They might faint if they have decreased cardiac output, things like that. Examination is variable. They might be tachy, they might be brady. They could be hypotensive if there's decreased cardiac output and may have additional heart sounds. Quickly, ECG to diagnose. If the source is coronary stenosis or occlusion, they'll respond to nitrates, glycerol trinitrate, which are vasodilators. Again, diagnostically, troponins. And there are other things you can do, like an echo, which is an ultrasound of the heart, looking for sections of the heart wall that aren't beating as well as others because they're now dead. And then for investigation and therapeutics, you can do a coronary angiogram, which is where dye is inserted into the coronary vessels. Did I have a picture? I did. Dye is inserted into the coronary vessels. This is the left main. Sorry, this is the left main. This is the LAD. This is the left circumflex. This is a complete stenosis of the left circumflex vessel there. So you can see where the occlusion is, and then you can insert things like balloons, balloon angioplasty, to get into the stenosis and expand it, pushing the plaque into the walls of the vessel and reopening up that area. Quick management, Mona of heart attacks, morphine, it hurts. Oxygen used to be given always, now it's not the recommendation. It's given if they have decreased oxygen sats, nitrates to open up the coronary vessels, and aspirin. Aspirin is a blood thinner. It should be given as soon as possible. Typically, a paramedic will crush up an aspirin and give it to them to drink on the way to the hospital, and you can have 3 or 4 or 5 by the time you get to the hospital. It doesn't matter. The definitive treatment of occlusion in the coronary vessels is, as we said here, ballooning or stenting of any occlusion here. Within the first, 60 minutes, you can give something called alteplase, which is a thrombolytic. It dissolves clots, but after that it's not indicated. And then more definitive management is bypass grafting, where you take a healthy vessel and you put it in place of your stenosed atherosclerotic coronary vessel. Valvular disease, quickly. Two main types, stenosis, which is abnormal narrowing, and regurgitation, which is when the valve doesn't close properly and allows leakage of blood backwards. Risk factors, age, it happens with everyone. If you have rheumatic heart disease, rheumatic valvular disease, you're more prone to getting valvular dysfunction, and any infection of the heart, particularly endocarditis, which seems to latch onto valves. So the causes, as I said, age, connective tissue diseases, and autoimmune, like lupus. And modifiable risk factors are hypertension, rheumatic heart disease, infection, and ischemia and trauma as well. Quickly, three ones to just touch on quickly. Aortic stenosis is obviously quite important. It's the major outflow of your heart. If you have aortic stenosis, you're not going to get good peripheral circulation to the rest of your body. Risk factors, as I said before, a bicuspid aortic valve is more prone to being stenosed, and also hypertension, because the aortic valve is the valve that's exposed to the highest pressure because it's the outflow from the left ventricle. Hypertension affects it most strongly. So this is an open stenotic aortic valve, and you can see it's nowhere near as wide as it needs to be to get good outflow. Mitral regurge happens particularly in ischemia, inferior and posterior ischemia, also in cardiomyopathy and endocarditis, and it can cause all valvular disease, I guess, can cause congestive heart failure, and depending on the location, pulmonary edema and pulmonary hypertension. This is an image of regurge here. The valve leaflets don't touch each other when closed, and because there's high pressure in a ventricle, the blood flows backwards into the atria or wherever it may be and doesn't facilitate the forward functional flow of blood. The tricuspid valve is kind of a buzzword for endocarditis in people who use intravenous drugs because it's the first valve that venous blood will touch, and the bacteria seems to latch onto that first. On examination with tricuspid regurge, because of the backflow of blood, you get pulsatile hepatomegaly. It's a nice buzzword for you. Generally, for valvular disease, start with patient education, lifestyle interventions. So it's a lot about maintaining a good fluid status in the patient, which means they don't have a lot of salts, and changing all of your cardiovascular risk factors. So don't smoke, decrease your alcohol, become more cardiovascularly fit. Pharmacological intervention basically is maintenance of not good blood pressure. In acute deterioration, you can give diuretics to offload fluids as well as vasodilators. Often, valves need surgical repair or complete replacement, either with a pig heart usually or a mechanical prosthetic heart. You'll go into management of all of these diseases so much more next year. This is just very basic. Heart failure. Heart failure is a failure of the heart to meet the physiological needs of the body. Basically, not pumping out enough blood to meet whatever needs your body is doing. Mismatch of supply and demands. Usually it's because something is wrong with the heart. It can't pump out enough, which is called a low output heart failure. But in rare cases, it's because of a high output heart failure, which is where the body has increased need in these states, for example, and many more. So anything that causes dysfunction of the heart can give heart failure. Most commonly, it's ischemic heart disease, so heart attacks. dilated cardiomyopathies, which are usually secondary to viral infection, and hypertension-induced cardiomyopathy and ventricular hypertrophy. Other causes are everything: cardiomyopathy, valvular disease, congenital diseases, arrhythmias with poor cardiac output, pericardial disease, which decreases cardiac expansion, and those increased states of need, as we said before. Risk factors depend on what causes it, obviously, but your general cardiovascular risk factors all apply: smoking, weight, diet, salt intake, hypertension, etc., etc., etc. I said hypertension twice because it's twice as important. Heart failure is classified in a number of different ways. This is the most widely accepted one that's actually used clinically. It's based on symptoms. From one, which is where you have no problems meeting your needs. So when you exercise, you don't get particularly short of breath. You don't get ankle swelling due to a venous backlog. Right through to four, which is where if I was sitting in a chair right now, I would be hyperventilating and peripherally swollen because my heart just can't keep up with the basal needs of my body and everything in between. Heart failure, as we know, when the heart goes wrong, you have many mechanisms which try to correct it. The problem with heart failure is that the underlying cause of this change isn't correctable, which means that you have chronic activation of your sympathetics, of your renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system, which actually, in the long term, are even worse for your heart. Chronic sympathetic activation actually results in cardiomyocyte apoptosis, and because you're pumping your heart even faster and harder. Again, your cardiomyocytes get damaged even more. So there's a really big negative feedback or self-fulfilling destruction of the heart that happens in cardiac failure. Interestingly, if you tell a patient, oh, you've got breast cancer, the survival of breast cancer in 10 years is something like 70%, something like that. But everyone, all the family members will come rush in and send them their well wishes. Cardiac failure, if you have congestive cardiac failure, the 5-year mortality death rate is 90%. But everyone's got heart failure in the ward and they don't care about it. I just got a bit of heart failure, it's fine. Just take my fluid offloading medication, my diuretics. But because of this system here, your heart is just declining and declining and declining until you won't be able to meet your needs, and it's fatal. So these are the mechanisms by which this system regulates itself. Probably not necessary level of detail for you. The very basic management of congestive cardiac failure, this is more than anything a problem of fluids. If you are fluid overloaded, your heart will not be able to pump it, and you'll go into things like acute pulmonary edema, in which you won't be able to breathe, and that can be potentially fatal. So it's maintaining fluid and salt restrictions. People who are on cardiac failure have things like a 1,500 ml fluid restriction per day, and they meet that every day, and they can't drink more than that. Salt restrictions of minuscule amounts as well. So with patient education, then your lifestyle, changing your cardiovascular risk factors, particularly salt and fluid. Medications you don't particularly have to worry about. Maintain blood pressure. ACE inhibitors and beta blockers each have a 25% mortality reduction in congestive cardiac failure for mechanisms which aren't important particularly. In acute phase, when people get fluid overload, you can give them diuretics. And then more permanent things depend on what caused the heart failure. So if it's an arrhythmia, you can pace them. You can put in an implantable cardioverter. If their ejection fraction, so how well their systolic function is markedly decreasing. And heart transplantation, but there's something like 30 heart transplants done a year in Australia. So that's not something you want to rely on. Getting near the end, guys. Well done. Powering through. Problems with the aorta. An aortic aneurysm is an abnormal widening of all three layers of a vessel of more than 50% size. Risk factors are your classic cardiovascular risk factors with a particular emphasis on connective tissue disorders, Marfan's, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, all have a high rates of that. Other things like syphilis infection can predispose you as well. We'll talk about abdominal aortic aneurysms, most of which are asymptomatic and are found when someone happens to do a CT abdo. And if they're found, they're monitored and the size monitored, and there's a cutoff value, which is 5.5 centimeters, doesn't matter what it is for you guys. Just know that they get monitored, and beyond a certain size, the risk of doing surgery to reduce it versus the risk of it rupturing counteract each other, the risk is less for surgery, and they're a candidate for surgical repair. Nowadays, it's not done open. If possible, if the aorta isn't too tortuous, it's done endovascularly, so through stent, through the inside of the vessels, where they deploy a stent along the internal walls of the vessel. So you still have your aorta, which has ballooned out, but you have created a false internal lumen so that the pressure exerted from the blood is on that stent rather than on the internal walls, so the internal walls won't rupture because there's no pressure on them. This is an intact AAA. A ruptured AAA is a medical emergency. 75% of people will die before they get to hospital. A further 50% will die even if they get into theater, and then from that, another 40 or 50% will die in the next 2 weeks, with an overall mortality of up to 90%. I know a first-year intern who is in ED on nights was examining someone who came in with vague abdominal pain, touched their abdomen, felt an expansile abdominal mass, so you can feel the heartbeat in the abdomen like that because the blood has pooled into the entire abdomen and is transmitting the cardiac force through the abdominal wall into your hands. Felt that, and then paged the surgical team because you need an urgent, needs urgent theatre, otherwise they'll die. Surgical team were unresponsive, so he took the patient in a trolley, in a lift, straight into theatre and called the surgical team on the way and said, I'll meet you in theatre, I'm bringing you a patient. And that patient survived because that intern knew this triad and knew this stat. That's great. So, medical emergency, this triad of abdominal pain, expansile abdominal mass, expansile abdominal mass, and hypotension, because your blood is in your abdomen, not in your circulation, should give you red flags. An aortic dissection is when there is a tear in the innermost layer of a vessel, typically in the aorta, because it's typically in high-pressure vessels, and a false passage of blood is created where the blood flows in between layers of the vessel wall. It's of sudden onset, associated with connective tissue disorders, high blood pressure, and cocaine use. Sudden onset, central chest or back pain, depending on where in the aorta it is, and a sensation of tearing, which is the actual separation of the layers of the heart tearing, and you feel that. Apparently it feels like the worst thing ever. Now, depending on where the dissection is, will depend on the symptoms you get. A dissection, because it creates a false lumen and it travels through the layers of the aorta, as it gets to things like subclavian vessels, it can cut off flow to those vessels, because if you imagine it's moving through the layers, the blood isn't reaching the internal lumen of the subclavian, it's actually passing around the walls, and as the blood reaches the area, it kind of stenoses the subclavian, but from within the walls of it. So you can get an ischemic limb, because you have a whole side of your whole limb that's not getting any blood supply, which is why, as part of the investigation of chest pain, you should always do blood pressure on both arms, because if you have one that's very low, you need an immediate surgical consult, because this person probably has a dissection. If it's proximal to the subclavian, it's called a Stanford A dissection. Distal, it's called a Stanford B. Coarctation means narrowing. It's a congenital anomaly of the aorta. Typically occurs at the point of the ligamentum arteriosum, which we talked about before, and associated with connective tissue diseases like Turner syndrome, connective tissue diseases and other diseases like Turner syndrome. Because it's a narrowing of the aorta, which the left heart pumps into, it's associated with left ventricular hypertrophy because it has to overcome that narrowing. It can be asymptomatic, or it can present as a baby who is born dead because they don't have enough outflow and they don't have flow to the body. Either born dead or dying within a couple of days of being born. This is why in your cardio exam you check for a radiofemoral delay, because the coarctation is typically after the subclavians, you get fine supply to subclavians, but your iliacs are not well perfused. Endocarditis is an inflammation itis of the endocardium. The endocardium not only lines the internal chambers of the heart, but also lines the valves of the heart. And because the valves are moving all the time and they're prone to getting diseased, vegetations from things like bacterial endocarditis, which is the most common cause, typically lodge on these valves. So it occurs in the context of a valve defect or some sort of heart damage. People who have prosthetic heart valves are particularly prone to getting it because they have something abnormal, non-anatomical in their heart. So it's typically an infective process, typically bacterial. Your two bacteria that you need to know are Strep viridans, which is the most common cause of just your classic infective endo, and your Staph aureus, which is a cutaneous bacteria, it's a skin bacteria. People who are intravenous drug users, when they use intravenous drugs, they don't do it cleanly because they haven't been taught how, so they push skin bacteria into their bloodstream and get a Staph aureus endocarditis. Globally, the most common cause of endocarditis or most common risk factor is rheumatic heart disease, but that doesn't really happen here apart from, unfortunately, in our indigenous population. There are other causes of endocarditis, vegetations on the valves, and inflammation outside of the context of infection. If you're hypercoagulable, you might get coagulable vegetations on the valves, and you can have deposition of autoimmune proteins in SLE on valves as well, but less important. Your clinical side of things, your trio of Janeway lesions, your painful ulcerous nodes, and your splinter hemorrhages are what you always look for. I just spoke to a cardiologist a couple of weeks ago who said he's seen this in one patient, and he's about 75. So it's good textbook learning, but we don't really get it here in Western society in metropolitan hospitals. Rough spots are seen upon fundoscopy as retinal hemorrhages associated with it. Now, this is a good rule. Any patient with a fever and a new murmur, which indicates valvular change, has endocarditis until proven otherwise. Good rule. You can image the valves with an echo to look at the actual vegetations, and management is dependent on the case, typically high-dose, long-term intravenous antibiotics, or surgery to correct a valve which is beyond repair and to prevent emboli. Because you have vegetations on the valves, those vegetations flick off and you have septic emboli, which can give you things like strokes. Which happened, we had a 40-year-old intravenous drug user in our cardiology wards who had infective endocarditis his third time and had been in hospital for 4 weeks while leaving hospital every night and to ongo intravenous drug use. And one day he didn't wake up because he had a clot flick off and he had a stroke and he died. I think lastly or second lastly, pericarditis and pericardial disease. Pericarditis, inflammation of the pericardium, which is your double-layered serous membrane enclosing your heart with a potential space in the middle. Pericarditis is usually always viral, and they don't bother testing what virus causes it because the management is the same. Other causes are rarely TB, advanced uremia and renal failure. Post-ischemia, you can get two types of pericarditis. You can get a pericarditis within a couple of days afterwards, which is a reaction to the kind of inflammatory state of the healing heart wall. And you can get something called Dresler's syndrome, which is a pericarditis post-ischemia, which occurs weeks to months later. Cancer, trauma are all other causes of pericarditis. The pain is sharp, pleuritic chest pain, so worse when breathing. And it's also worse when you're lying flat, interestingly. So people who say, oh, it's really sharp pain, but it's fine when I lean forward, you want to think pericarditis, gastroesophageal reflux disease, things like that. On auscultation, you hear that classic pericardial rub, which sounds like hair rubbing together and actually does when you get to hear it. Because it's an inflammatory state, you get effusion of fluid into this potential space, which usually only holds 15 mils of fluid or so. And this can grow and grow and grow and actually impedes the expansion of the heart. And when you get enough fluid in that space, which causes decreased cardiac function, that's called cardiac tamponade, which is a complication of pericarditis. So it's fluid in the pericardial space. Can also be caused by congestive cardiac failure, nephrotic syndrome, trauma, malignancy, and blood post-surgery. If you have surgery on the heart and you have leakage of blood into the pericardial space, you'll very, very, very quickly get cardiac tamponade. Also, ventricular rupture occurs after AMI about 5 to 7 days after ischemia, your ventricular wall is damaged and it leaks, it breaks, and you have blood extravasating out of the ventricle into the pericardial space, and that can cause a very fast tamponade as well. The triad of cardiac tamponade is these three things here: muffled heart sounds, pulsus paradoxus, and increased JVP. This is essentially management of infective pericarditis here. Because it's an inflammatory state and viral, you don't really do anything to stop the viral progression. You just give anti-inflammatory treatment, which is typically NSAIDs. You can pericardiocentese, so draw out the fluid from the pericardial cavity to relieve symptoms. They're very, very short of breath, or they're getting decreased cardiac output. And other causes depends on other underlying treatments depend on other underlying malignancies. Well done, guys. Powered through. 2 hours. Well done. Thank you. I have something to say about each of these. The first incision is a surgical publication, which is student-run. We publish every 2 months or so. If you're interested in surgery, or not sure if you're interested in surgery, sign up and read it. We're also about to start hiring for our 2017 team, so keep your eyes peeled. The Australian Medical Student Journal is also hiring for our 2017 team. You can't be uni rep because that's me, sorry. But they're hiring for a financial officer, social media officer, events coordinator, external director, lots of roles there. They're a really great group of people. I highly recommend it. MUSIG for your VIA is running an anatomy revision night very soon. I think tickets to be open very soon. Cool. Get amongst it. I'll be there. Access Monash, guys. If you're interested in helping people from underprivileged schools gain access into tertiary education, give up some time to mentor, please do that. And make sure to come to Super Vesper as well. Thanks, guys.